Can I get a good amen in this house?
Welcome back to the Good Amen. We're here today with some ECU Greenville legends here.
The legends.
And so Parker is. He just got off the phone with Donald Trump.
Did you really?
Oh my goodness.
What a way to start the conversation.
Wow.
Yeah. It was crazy.
He's at a UFC. Did he call you from the UFC fight the other day?
I actually asked him about it.
Did you?
Yeah, I did.
So that's awesome.
He called me and it was a no call ID. And it's the middle,
I bet it was.
Middle of the day. So I'm like, who's calling me from a no call ID? But my dad, we have some connections and some agents, and my dad basically was like, hey, any, like, number you don't know, like, answer the phone. It might be a no-call ID. I'm like, why is that? And he's like, well, there's some special people, like, wanting to call you and stuff. So I was like, all right. And so I answered the phone, and at first, like, it's just his voice. I was like, this is, like, somebody that's just playing with me.
Yeah.
And
I bet.
And then he starts like, he's like, hey, this is Donald Trump. I'm like, what? I was like, hey, man. Like, I didn't know what to say because, I mean, it's Donald Trump. I'm like, what's up, man? And he's like, Parker, like, I've heard great things about you and have some connections in Atlanta, which that's when I put two and two together that it was actually real because that's where that agent was from. And it was just, it was crazy. I mean, we talked about prosthetics, talked about Tiger Woods and his issues with his leg. I mean, just name-dropping Tiger Woods.
Name-dropping Tiger Woods. And like, anybody knows who that is.
Exactly. And then I was like, I asked him about the USC fight. I was like, how was it? He's like, I mean, those guys are tough, but not as tough as you, man. I'm like, I don't know about that. They get into the ring knowing what's going to happen.
Golly.
But, I mean, it was cool.
I had no idea. Your dad never said anything about
that. Yeah, well, it just happened. So
that is awesome.
Yeah.
Did you tell him you were on the way to the Good Amen podcast?
Yes. I'm sorry. I did not.
You didn't say that.
But I did. I had to mention my sister, my Brindley, my little sister, because, I mean, she's the biggest Trumpy out there.
And, Trumpy out there.
In 2020, man, she was eating it up.
That is awesome.
And that's awesome.
Man. What a wild ride.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't imagine. That's not what I expected to talk about here. I had no idea.
But,
you know,
yeah.
You never know with a good amen what's going to happen.
That's right.
But Parker's been on before. We've heard a lot of his story before. And so thanks for being on again. And we also have Coach Cliff Godwin here, ECU head baseball coach.
Snow Hill.
From Snow Hill, local
Snow
guy.
Snow Hill, local
Heck
guy.
Yeah.
Big metropolis of Snow Hill.
That's right. That's right.
That's right. There's like four restaurants there.
Four. Maybe.
Maybe.
We've had
travel balls there all the time,
that's
I promise.
Right. Oh, my gosh. It's crazy the things that are in Snow Hill. Like, there's like a big theater program or something in Snow Hill.
I had no idea. Snow Hill. All I've been there for is
the best. They didn't have that 30 years ago when I was growing up. But
that's awesome.
But I will say, and we've had Coach Houston on as well, and so hopefully he's not listening, but ECU baseball is my favorite thing to go watch at ECU, which I'm not from the area. So I've got my collegiate allegiance elsewhere,
just
but I'll be locked
where,
in.
Just tell them where.
I'm an Oklahoma fan, through and through.
Sorry,
Boomer Sooner.
We beat them twice in the regional.
You know, that's what I'm saying. So there we go.
I'm right there. Yes, sir.
And so, but ECU baseball is so fun. I love going out there. And so, man, thank you for being on. Thank you for taking some time.
Well, I appreciate the support, and I don't think Coach Houston should be mad. We've got to have baseball fans too, right?
That's right.
That's exactly right, baby. Let's go.
That's right. I'm more apt to go to a baseball game than a football game. I'll just go ahead and say that.
Well, it's more intimate.
Oklahoma's a little bit better at football too. So I don't feel
No, the baseball scene is legit here.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
It is serious.
Absolutely.
Like, just the other day, they had the record crowd ever.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, it's wild. And they're having to bump that up gradually. Cause
exactly. The fire marshals.
The fire marshals are after JJ
on that.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Man, well, thank you so much for being on here. Why don't you tell us a little bit? I'd love to just hear some of your story. You mentioned a little bit that you're from the area, from Snow Hill, and kind of what was the journey to get to ECU here today?
Man, this is going to be long, so I'll try to keep it short. But I did grow up in Snow Hill. My parents both were in the school system. My mom was the school nurse, and my dad was a basketball coach. So I make the joke that they knew I was in trouble before I did because they were both at the high school. My grandparents were, on my mom's side, were tobacco farmers. And so in the summers, I had to work in the tobacco fields, and I tell people that's where I got my best education, even though I have 2 degrees from East Carolina. My grandfather was just a great human being. Like, he believed in hard work, and he would always have this saying to me, which we didn't have mules, so I'm not that old, but he would be like, hey, the mule's in the ditch. You got to figure out how to get them out. And it would just be a problem. And he wouldn't tell me how to. He would just say, hey, you need to figure this situation out. And even before I could work, I just was with my grandfather all the time because I just loved being around him. He never missed a sporting event when I was in high school, whether it was football, basketball, or baseball. And so I'd always told my mom I would never come to East Carolina because it was too close to home. I felt like she'd be in my dorm room every weekend. And
a lot of kids say that. Yeah, a lot of kids say, I'm never going.
You sound like Grayson right now.
Yeah, so I know. I know.
That's her debate.
And I only applied to one school, early admission, and it was to the University of North Carolina, and I got accepted. And thank God I didn't get the Moorhead Scholarship because if I'd have gotten that scholarship, my parents would have made me go to North Carolina because it's a full ride. Mm-hmm. And my dream was to play college basketball. I mean, I was in the gym all the time with my dad. And unfortunately, I was a 6-foot white dude that could shoot, but wasn't athletic enough to play college basketball. And I was really a better basketball and football player in high school than I was a baseball player. But everybody told me, if you just focus on baseball, that's going to be your ticket. And I had one small scholarship offer in baseball. I had more offers in basketball and football at smaller schools than I had for baseball. Wow. And it was to come to East Carolina. And the reason was because my high school coach, who's in the North Carolina Sports Hall of Fame, James Rabbit Fulgham, had sent guys to East Carolina that were good players, like a Tommy Eason, a Jason Head. And he basically twisted Coach Overton's arm and said, hey, if you'll take a shot on this kid, he's probably going to have to redshirt, but he's going to end up being okay one day. And, thank God it was Coach Overton before Coach LeClaire was hired, because if Coach LeClaire would have been there, he'd have looked at Coach Fulgham and said, hey, look, I hear what you're saying, and you're a legend, but that dude ain't good enough to play here.
And Fulgham is a – I mean, he's a legend. I mean, Coach Fulgham is like baseball gold over there.
And, I mean, you're talking about the North Carolina Sports Hall of Fame. You're not talking about a high school association. You're talking about the one that Michael Jordan's in.
That's exactly right. He's the real deal.
And so I come here, I redshirt my freshman year, and this isn't a knock against anybody, but when you redshirted, it was – you were kind of on your own.
Right.
And I got to hit on the field like twice a week. and if you got your bunts down, you got 8 swings. If you didn't get your bunts down, you got 4 swings. And me and Kevin Monroe and Jimmy Forrest, who works for Garrett now, we would basically play home run derby in those swings and bet on something like, hey, whoever wins, the other two got to buy them dinner tonight.
That's right.
So that was my development. I did get stronger, but I was playing basketball at the rec center every weekend when they were on the road traveling. And then that summer – we hire Keith LeClaire, and no Twitter, no social media, but just in the newspaper, this guy says, hey, we're going to play in the College World Series. And I'm like, I just redshirted on a bad team. This guy's talking about the College World Series that's like on TV. I better get my crap together pretty quickly. I'm probably not going to be here. And I tell our players this, that I really just focused on what I could control. So I was a good student. That was a plus. I was a really hard worker. I wasn't a great baseball player, so I just gave him no reason other than me striking out or making an error that, hey, this dude's low maintenance. He had enough other stuff to worry about his first year. And, man, he beat the crap out of us. It was like Navy SEAL training in the fall. And, I mean, this is a true story. Our first obstacle course, we had real barbed wire in it.
Oh, my gosh.
And it's where the white lot, it's where the white lot is now. It used to be an old practice soccer field. And there was just a low area where he put some water in, and there was real barbed wire. If you came up, man, you just got
cut.
You were
feeling it,
Today, obviously, you get fired for stuff like that.
You were getting hazed before any of this stuff.
By the coach.
By the coach.
Yeah.
Like, we're getting this done.
Yeah. And so I just, you know, worked my tail off, and we had great teams. And I was a very small piece, and I tell our guys that, you know, I hit 7-hole in the 2001 team. Who we were the first team that ever won a regional, and we couldn't host here on campus because of it was Harrington Field. It was a high school field.
That's it.
And then we lost in the super regional in 2001 in Kinston, and I made the last out of the super regional. I was a time run at the plate in game 2. I had 15 home runs on the year. It was a 1-0 pitch. It was a 1-0 changeup. I was sitting on it, and I hit left-handed, and I just skied it to second base. I just missed it. And at that moment, I didn't – when it was over, I didn't know what I was going to do because I had put all my eggs in one basket. Like, yeah. I played sports my whole life, and when I came to college, I thought I was going to be a lawyer. I was going to come to East Carolina. I was going to get my undergrad, and then I was going to go to law school somewhere. That was the plan. I actually worked for Taft and Hagler here in town one summer. But it ended, and I played independent ball for a couple years, just to, for a space holder. Yeah. Finished up my master's, and one Christmas I was going to the Glaxo Welcome basketball tournament, and Wells Gulledge, who was the head basketball coach at Kenson High School at the time, was good friends, and I went to go see him play, and the principal, Craig Hill, was at the game, and we're on the out-of-bounds, like, just talking. He says, hey, what are you doing now? I said, well, I just finished up my master's, and this was December of 02, and I want to get into college coaching, but it's a bad time. He says, well, how about if you come work at Kenson High School this spring, be our assistant coach, I'll create a tutoring position for you, pay you as a teacher. And then next year, Ronnie Battle's going to retire after that. You'll be our head baseball coach at Kenson. Like a 30-second conversation.
Good gracious.
On the sideline. Reynolds Coliseum was.
Wow.
And I looked at him. I said, can I go home and, like, think about it? But at the time, I was like, I'm doing lessons, and I'm, like, making, like, $40 a week. Like, some random kids want some lessons. And he's going to pay me to coach baseball. And – I know people are saying I'm not going to be able to get into college if I go to high school, but I'm not making any money.
Right.
I need to figure out something to make some money. And so I did that for the spring of 03. And then that summer, Coach Scaff from UNC Wilmington called and said, hey, would you be interested in being our volunteer assistant? You're going to make no money.
Wow. But,
and I'm like, absolutely. I'm in because I want to coach college baseball. And I was there for a year, and it was a great experience. And then went to Vanderbilt. The next summer as the director of baseball operations, back when there wasn't even – I didn't know what that meant.
Yeah.
Because it was 20 years ago, and, man, what a learning experience for me to work with one of the best head coaches in the country. And Eric Backage, who's one of my best friends who played with me here at East Carolina, he was kind of the one that got my foot in the door, and then was the assistant at Notre Dame for 1 year.
Notre Dame.
Yeah, which that's a funny story in itself, and I'm trying not to take up too much time. But
you're fine. This is amazing. I've never heard any of this.
Yeah, so I was actually the head coach of the Wilmington Sharks in the summer of the Coastal Plain League. Still the ops guy, Vandy, and Tim Corbin let me do that. And Coach Kevin McMullen, who's now the associate head coach at UVA, he had coached me at East Carolina for 2 years. He's my hitting and catching coach, and he called me up, and he says, hey, you want to be the hitting and catching coach at a top 25 program? I'm like, yeah. And he goes, Notre Dame. And I go, what? Notre Dame? Are they good in baseball? Like, I just watch them on Saturdays on NBC growing up playing football. And you know, like, he goes, they're good. He says, the job's yours. Just don't F up the interview. Got it, Coach Mack. Hey, no problem. No pressure there.
That's awesome.
Yeah. And so, I mean, I'd never been to South Bend, Indiana.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, talking about cold, buddy.
I bet. Not baseball weather.
Not baseball.
Did y'all have the shiny helmets then? Or
We might have had some gold shiny helmets.
Uniforms.
Well,
have to be
definitely
cool.
The football team.
Yeah,
for sure.
So
it was there for 1 year, and Coach Maneri told me that it was the mildest winter in his 13 years at Notre Dame. And I'm like, hey, Coach, if this is the mildest winter,
I'm out.
I'm out, dude. Like, this ain't fun, man. And then he got the LSU job that next summer, and he took us, the assistants, with him down there. So I was at LSU for 2 years. We went to Omaha in 2008, and a lot of people don't know, but the relationship between Coach Maneri and I was strained a little bit, and I'll take some blame for it, my ego, you know, and I wanted things done a certain way, and so our pitching coach got the head coaching job at UCF, and he recruited me like a first-round draft pick to go be there and be the recruiting coordinator, associate head coach. And it was a tough time because at that time I had just told Terry I would go with him to UCF. North Carolina had assistant coaching position come up. And if you'd have looked at my resume versus the other two candidates, and one is one of my best friends, Scott Jackson, who's the head coach at Liberty we just played. He let me live with him when I was a volunteer assistant at UNCW, not making any money in the middle of the year. Basically, I had to move out of the place I was living for free. And he says, hey, you're going to move in with me. I go, I can't move in with you. Like, yeah. You have a wife. Like, yeah. I don't even know Sarah that good. Like, I'm going to just get a blow up mattress thrown in the locker room. He goes, no, grab your stuff. You're going into my house.
Wow.
So he was one of the guys and another guy. But like the rat on a sheet of paper, if you'd have taken the names off, and I'm not trying to be arrogant, but my resume for what I had done was better. And he was a pitching coach, and they were hiring a hitting coach. But a blessing. God's always got a plan, as you know. And so I didn't get the job. I was devastated because I wanted to come back home. Yeah. Like, I'd been gone away. I just want to come back home. And so thankful that I didn't get the job because I got thrown into a state of Florida, which I had been to when I was five, Disney World. And now you're the recruiting coordinator. And no offense, nobody wanted to come to UCF because we were bad. And you're trying to sell kids on a vision.
Yeah.
And I learned the state of Florida because I was there for 3 years.
Wow.
Jeff Palumbo, who's now my associate head coach, he was the other assistant. So we worked together for 3 years. That's how that connection came. And then Ole Miss came calling after 3 years, and I wasn't looking to move. Orlando, you can throw a baseball and find a player.
That's yeah.
Now, Orlando's got a lot of concrete and a lot of traffic, which that's not my style.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so, Coach.
Not coming from Snow Hill.
Not coming from Snow Hill, man. You know, and
more trees.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so, Coach Bianco at Ole Miss called and said, would you be? And I said, yeah, I'm interested. But really, I'd already coached in the SEC.
Yeah.
That's something that people want to talk about. Hey, you know, have you coached in the SEC? So, that wasn't like something I needed to check the box again. And so, I get there for the visit, and it just reminded me so much of Eastern North Carolina, Oxford, Mississippi. It's a college town. When I was at LSU, we played there. There was 11,000. Eli Manning threw out the first pitch.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, this feels like home, dude.
Right.
Like, this is a good gig. And so, go there for 3 years. We go to Omaha in 2014, and the job's open here at East Carolina. My parents got divorced when I graduated high school, so both my parents are in Omaha. I don't talk to them at all about East Carolina. Yeah. Flew to Omaha, had an interview at the Doubletree Hotel on a Saturday morning at 7:30 in the morning. And finally, my mom, all 5'2" of her, like the day after the interview, she goes, comes into my hotel room and goes, hey, look, I'm getting a lot of calls from back home. And did you interview for the East Carolina job? And I said, Mom, I did. But I didn't want them to get their hopes up because
You've already been disappointed before.
Yeah, you know what I mean? And I didn't want to say, hey, I'm coming home just to come home. I wanted to make sure East Carolina was committed to winning at the highest level and competing for a national championship. And once they were, I'm like, hey, I feel good. And it's never been all about money for me because the AD at Ole Miss at the time, Ross Bjork's in the dugout in Omaha. He goes, hey, look, I don't know how much East Carolina's paying you, but I'll pay you more to stay here. So I felt like, man, this was a moment that I couldn't pass up and come back here. And, man, when you become a head coach, you think you're, like, so prepared.
Yeah.
Like, I was considered at the time one of the top assistants in the country. You come in, and, dude, there ain't no handbook. When hey, you know this because you sit in the big chair.
That's right.
And Coach Bianco used to always tell me at Omega's, hey, be careful what you ask for.
That's exactly right.
Man, that first fall, dude, I was, like, working my tail off, and nobody tells you you're doing a good job.
No.
Nobody. And you didn't recruit the players, but they're your players. That was one thing that I wanted to make sure, like, hey, like, you are our players.
Yeah.
You're part of the East Carolina family. But that fall, I worked them close to how Coach LeClaire worked us, where we were trying to get people to quit.
Yeah.
Like, hey, man, like, you got to be bought into what we're doing.
You got to figure out who's here and who's not.
Just no barbed wire.
No barbed wire. No. Probably had things close to that. But no barbed wire.
We'll not speak of those.
Yeah. But we had 27 players on the team when the spring rolled around.
Wow.
And you could have 35 at that time.
Yeah.
So some people left. Some people were forced to leave. And we had 26 healthy. So you didn't even have to put up a travel roster.
Wow.
You could travel 27. We only had 26 healthy. Man, hey, you're in the locker room. Hey, get on the bus, man. We're going.
Rolling.
And you think about now, like, those are some of the biggest issues, like, you know, having to leave guys back because you have 40 on the team and you can only travel 30 and stuff. And I look back. Now, that team was tough.
Yeah.
I can tell you. We won 40 games. And Jeff Palumbo, who's been with me the whole time, he would tell you that whenever we go to Omaha, that probably was still our best coaching job.
Wow.
To be able to go to a regional in our first year and win 40 games. And that team laid the foundation. And 16, we were up and down. We lost the first two games of the conference tournament, and I was so ticked off. And the rule is if we go 0-2 at the conference tournament, which is in Clearwater, then we bus home. We don't fly home. Ooh. We bus home. So a 14 hours on a bus with all them.
Stewing on it.
And we came back, and, man, we practiced hard. And we went to UVA that year, and we won the regional there. And went to Texas Tech and won the first game. And I'll never forget their head coach, Tim Tadlock, in his post game goes, they're a lot better in person than they are on video. And I was like, that's kind of a backhanded compliment, know. And I'm just like sitting there. And so you go to game two, and the bottom of the 12th inning, I think, we had bases loaded and Brady Lloyd's up. And he hits a ball at the middle when it goes off the bat. That's the only time I've ever thought we were going to Omaha. And I was like, this is happening. Year two, this is happening. And the ball hits the mound and kicks directly to the second baseman, and he flips it to the shortstop. And then we lose in 13 innings, and then we get crushed in game three. The whole time, Alabama had been courting me. And at that moment, I wasn't mature enough. I don't know what my answer would have been if that ball had gone up the middle, but – I mean, Alabama basically was going to double my salary, and I thank God that I bought it go up the middle. Man, you talk about powerful stuff, man. Like, I would have never coached our first recruiting class. I would have never coached Spencer Brickhouse, Bryant Packard, Alec Burleson, just all these guys that we recruited that, yeah, they were great players, man, but they're great people. And so the ball didn't go up the middle, and I was so ticked at East Carolina because I'm like, they're letting me get on a plane to go to Tuscaloosa?
Yeah.
Like, I coach in the SEC. The only thing that's different down there is this brand-new $42 million stadium that they have. So, like, you guys are really – y'all want me to go see that in person?
Yeah.
And I was giving JJ a hard time, and I don't run because my knees and stuff. I had, like, ran 2 miles that morning. My flight was out of Greenville at, like, 12:45. At 11 o'clock, I got no clothes packed. Because I'm like, there's no way they're letting me get on that plane. Sure enough, they let me get on that plane. And I go down there, and funny story, Bill Battle, who actually played football for Bear Bryant, he was an interim AD, and I appreciate him being an interim AD because this would only happen with the interim AD. He was a very successful businessman. The AD previously had kind of died suddenly, so they just got him to kind of fill the gap. Within the first hour of the interview that I'm there, I'm in his office. He says, how much will it take for you to be the head baseball coach at Alabama? And I was like, Mr. Battle, look, I really haven't thought, and I really hadn't.
Yeah.
I said, I hadn't thought about it. And you know, he goes, no, I want you to tell me a number. I mean, he's like sticking it to me. And I said, so my mind's racing because I'm trying to get a number up in my head that I'm like, so, well, look, I don't think I should be paid at the top, but I should be paid at the bottom. And a couple of SEC coaches at that time started making $1 million. So I said, $700,000. And he said, do you know how much our previous head coach made? I said, yes, sir. I said, $350,000. And he says, and you're asking for $700,000? I said, well, like I said, I don't think it should be compensated at the top or the bottom, but somewhere in the middle. So got back to my hotel room that night with my agent. We're doing the math. The average salary for SEC baseball coach at the time was $695,000. So I nailed it.
Yeah, you know, right.
Stayed at the Bear Bryant suite. The last person that had stayed in that suite, they had a little guest registry sign, Bobby Bowden. So I signed my name right under Bobby Bowden. Don't have a picture, but God's my witness. And I called Jeff Confer at the time, and you know, I probably didn't do it as tactfully as I should have at the time, but I just said, hey man, like the stuff I asked for, if you don't have this stuff, then I'm going to be the next head baseball coach at Alabama, and the press conference is going to be on Friday, and this was on a Tuesday night. So I flew back Wednesday, and I'm sweating because Bill Battle's like, hey, call me tomorrow afternoon when you get back settled and tell me what the number is for yourself and for your assistants, because I've always said if I was going, hey, man, my people are coming with me, brother. Like,
that's awesome.
Hey. I wouldn't be where I am without those people. So they're coming. And I always cleared it with them. Like, hey, man, like, if this happens, like, you guys ready to move to Tuscaloosa? So get back. And about 2 o'clock, Jeff Confer calls me and says, hey, we reached terms of agreement with your agent and everything's going to be taken care of. So I had an hour of grace time where Bill Battle called me at 3. And I just said, hey, man, I can't do it. The timing's not right. And I just thank God for that. It was I never talked to my parents about job opportunities. Yeah. I'm not proud about it, but I called both of them before I got on a flight to Tuscaloosa and said, hey, I'm sorry if I take this job, but I need East Carolina to step up a little bit.
And, that's amazing.
But we wouldn't have the hitting indoor, the pitching indoor, the video board, all that stuff if, you know, opportunities hadn't come up.
Wow.
And if you'd have asked me, I'm going to be the head coach here for 10 years when I got the job, and we have not played in the College World Series, I'd have lost everything I had.
Yeah.
Because that's how much I believed, and I still do, but I know God has me here for a reason.
Yeah.
I mean, being here with Parker Burr through everything, and I don't tell him this enough, but, man, I wouldn't trade that for any amount of money, dude. Mm. And I know God has me right where he wants me to be, and do the losses hurt when you're so close? You daggone right they do. But I know that we are doing it the right way, and we've got great people. And all. None of our kids are perfect, and neither am I. But just how our guys have – Carter Cunningham just developed the faith stuff in our locker room. And it's never forced by me, and people from the outside sometimes want to – like, hey, you're going to write the starting lineup. Who's Christians? Come on, dude.
Yeah.
Come on, man. Like,
well, I've had the chance to meet a lot of your past players. I mean, a lot of them are still here, and they're all. I mean, Spencer, like, he's taught my boys hitting. I mean, he's just a great, great guy. He's been a great voice in their life, and Packer. I mean, you just got great character people around the program. But I would say to you, like, this group of guys, what God is doing in them is very unique. And, you know, baseball is very important. But what we're seeing, like, through all the baptisms that happened a few weeks ago, just the character of the kids, it's a really, like, God's in this in a real unique, powerful way. It's a powerful moment in the program, and you can feel it. And, you know, a lot of it being on the outside, I mean, I didn't really know. I mean, I've known you, but I haven't really ever. We've never had really deep conversation or anything like that. And but really, what's happened, and it's kind of amazing. I mean, I know you're sitting here listening to all this, but you know, the first time I met you, you were walking out of the church, and obviously, we had a conversation with your dad. He broke down and cried the first time.
Imagine that.
It's amazing. But ever since, like, this has happened, the testimony that God's been weaving in your life and how it's impacted so many other lives is just, it's only God can do that, man.
Yeah, that's it.
You know?
I mean, we were talking to Carter Cunningham's mom the other day, and just like as a unit of the baseball team, she was talking to somebody at UBE, and I think she had on one of Carter's shirts or something, and the girl came up to her and was like, hey, what Carter's doing, like, with faith on East U campus is amazing. And I'm not quite sure what the status of Carter Cunningham's mom with her faith and all that, but I know at one point she didn't believe, and Carter's kind of planting that seed in her, and she's definitely growing. So it's cool to see that. But it's just, she said that the lady told her, was like, hey, like, I just want you to know that church baptized 100 people after seeing you guys get baptized on the field that day. And she's like, and then another group baptized like 8 or 9 people after seeing you guys just do that on the field. And so just planting that seed in other people. Yeah. Just, I mean, Carter's been great. Charlie Hodges, both of them have been phenomenal at just leading the faith part of this team. And not only are they doing it for this year, but they're also like kind of recruiting people for next year. So like. Yeah. Carter's already telling me, like, hey, like, I need you.
You're up.
Yeah, that's like, awesome. Hey, you're next. Like, I need you to continue to do this. And, like I planned a seed. I want you guys to just keep growing.
So good.
And so, I mean, not only are they doing it for this year, but for next year and years to come. And, I mean, this is a great place to be and a great time.
That's awesome. Well, Coach, I mean, talk, if you don't mind, from your perspective. I mean, you were sharing some stuff even before we started recording about kind of your journey and all this, you know, and I mean, you've been a Greenville guy for a long time, and you're like me. I sowed a lot of wild oats in this area, you know, and it's kind of crazy to outlive the reputation you've had.
Oh,
and it really reveals the grace and mercy of God. I mean, it's really crazy. But I mean, anybody that's come in contact with you over these last few years, I mean, God's been doing like something real in your life. And I just, you know, I honor that, and I think it's an amazing thing. But What's been the journey for you in this, and then coming to this specific year, which is just, it is different, man.
Yeah, so going back to my childhood, I grew up in Rainbow United Methodist Church.
Rainbow.
Man, right in the middle between Snow Hill, Snow Hill and Kinston. And, you know, in the Methodist Church, every 5 years you get a different preacher.
Yeah.
And I was, as a kid, I always like, man, like, why are we getting a different preacher? Well, and so middle school-ish.
Transfer portal.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, at least they had to stay there 5 years. So before they
graduated.
Sweet Lord. We had a preacher's name named Ray Broadwell, and I hope he hears this at some point in time. But I went through confirmation class with Ray Broadwell, and, man, I was eating it up, dude. Like,
wow.
Middle school, just all in. I get baptized, and then he leaves. And I do feel bad about this part, but the next pastor, I can't tell you his name, but this was during my high school years, and I just didn't get it. But one of your sermons in the new year was, hey, it's not the preacher's job for you to get the word. That's your job, because it's your personal relationship. And that hit home to me. It made me flash back to this moment.
Yeah.
But it was the high school year, so I mean, I was more worried about, hey, girls, what time lunch was, and then I'm going to the gym to play basketball, and then chasing girls.
Yeah,
those were, hey, school, basketball, baseball, football, and then girls. If there were some time, girls. That was, and I'm not proud about it, but that was my life. And then my parents get divorced, and my mom moves out the day that I graduate high school, and I went to college.
Yeah,
hey, didn't process it, just went and did what college guys do.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Hey, ran, I'll throw GB under the bus, ran with Garrett Blackwater and did all the things hey that I'm not proud of. And it was baseball, school, chasing girls, and I told you this, that winning was my drug. I competed at everything, and I wanted to win at everything, and I would do whatever it took to win. And never connected with a female, wouldn't let myself connect, and I'm sure some of it had to do with my parents getting divorced, but that doesn't give me a reason to be able to do it. But my reputation wasn't good with the ladies, and I'm sorry. And then I got into coaching after I played, and it was chasing success. Mm-hmm. And I told myself at some point in time, I'll never let my identity be the recruiting coordinator at whatever school or the assistant coach at Ole Miss, and I want to be Cliff Godwin. But I really wasn't. I was living what I said I wasn't going to do. And then I come to East Carolina, and the goal was we're going to go to Omaha, and then I'm going to go to a different, bigger job and make more money. And, hey.
This is the ladder.
This is the ladder. And started in the fall of 21. And I mentioned to you this early, and I'll try to get through this, but Nico Agnos passing away was a big blow, because I had a relationship with Nico because of Jake, who's older than Zach, so I'd known him for about 8 years. Yeah. And, I mean, we were texting. He's in the hospital, and then he dies. And I'm like, the guy's, like, checking on me, and he's in the hospital, and he's asking me how I'm doing, and then he's not here. And then, you know, when Lee Jake and Zach's mom called me on that Friday, man, there's no textbook for that.
Yeah.
Zach was lifting weights, and I went into the coach's locker room, and I cried, and I didn't know. So then I set my office, and Parker knows this, but you walk through the glass doors, I can kind of see when they're walking in if I'm sliding my chair over a little bit. And so I had to slid my chair over, and Zach walks in, and I said, hey, Zach, you need to call your mom. And he looked at me and goes, is everything okay? I said, yeah, everything's okay, because I couldn't. That's not my place to tell him. So Lee tells him, of course, we're super emotional. I said, hey, dude, you're getting in my car. We're going to go grab some stuff from your house, and we're going to Northern Virginia. And people made that a bit like a big deal that I did that. What the hell else was I going to do?
Exactly.
Like, I mean, if my dad passed away, I would want you to go, hey, man,
exactly,
hey, we're going to Snow Hill.
That's
like,
it. We're getting in this
and
going
together. We're going together. And, we got in the car, and, of course, we talked, and Zach called one person, Webb Tindall, as we're pulling into his neighborhood. And I tell people
the
impact.
Shout out to Webb, man. Yeah. Webb Tindall's an unbelievable human.
Yep. And he helps run our sport works and does devotional with our guys with Jamin Shelby. But I tell people that's the impact Webb's had on our program, because your dad passes away and you call one person as Webb Tindall, Amen.
Well, it tells you already what everything you needed to know too as, yeah. As a coach. Yeah,
absolutely. So that happens, and then, of course, because we take the team up to Nico's Celebration of Life, and Eric Ritchie gets COVID. Well, I'm sitting like kind of a seat away from him. So then I get COVID. COVID puts me on my tail, and it always affects me in a bad way mentally. And then I get to the season, and then you get back to the winning dopamine, we're playing bad. Yeah, we got swept by Brian at home, and people were like, God, you guys suck, you know. And I knew we were good, but our preseason practices were bad. I'm like, hey, man, like I saw, like I didn't know we were going to lose all three games, but I could see.
You saw the writing on the wall a little bit.
And then we get hot, and we win 20 games in a row, and, you know, win the regular season again, win the conference championship. We had never won the regular season and the conference championship together. In the same year, host the regional and then host the super regional, win game one, you're up in game two. And when you've been as close as East Carolina, you never let your mind go to like, man, this is happening. But there are people counting outs. There's people calling Omaha like, hey, you know, trying to get hotel rooms 100%. And stuff. And so we lose, you know, and then, of course, you got rain and we get beat again. And, man, I was crushed, you know. I didn't know why this keeps happening. You know, you question a lot of things. And John Gilbert gave me a new deal, and I was appreciative of that. So it was a little bit of a adrenaline high.
Yeah, for sure.
And then July 23rd happens in the summer of 22, and Jeff's calling me, and I'm meeting with the recruit. Kid ends up committing to Ole Miss. But
bad decision.
Sorry, coach.
Like, my Apple Watch normally don't even go off because I don't have it on alert. Right. And, like, it's just vibrating on my wrist. And I'm trying not to be rude and look down at me. But I finally, like, look down and it's Jeff Bird. And I'm like, man, something ain't right. But I was finishing up with the recruit, and I just told the family, hey, look, you guys go with Coach Palumbo, but I just got to step away for a minute because one of my parents and my players is calling. And I'll never forget. And Jeff is, of course, frantic.
Yes.
And, hey, can you get to the hospital? And I'm like, of course, like I'll be there in 5 minutes. I'm getting in my car right now. I'll be there. And so I actually got to the emergency room even before Dixon Williams, Miles Curley, Colby Thorndike, and Parker's girlfriend at the time. And just standing outside, I'm watching these wildlife officers pull all these 18-year-olds separately, and they're having to go through and write down exactly what happened. And a lot of unknown right there. Like, I never got to see Parker. So Jeff, you know, tire blows out, he's going 100 probably down the road, and just luckily there's, you know, a gas station right there that has the tire that, like, you talk about God.
I mean,
Parker's here because of God.
I
tell people all the time when I'm telling about the accident, I mean, there's 5 18-year-olds on a boat and they're not drinking alcohol.
That's
like,
right.
Hey, when does that happen?
I know. Didn't happen when I was growing up.
No,
sure.
And he's not here if they're drinking.
That's exactly right.
He's not here if there's not a good Samaritan boyfriend, girlfriend that are in an argument that just happened to be going the boat, and she's a nurse and shows him how to do a tourniquet.
That's exactly right.
I mean, and
God moments.
Yeah, for sure. And so, you know, all this happens, and Dr. Osment, this is a funny story about being a preacher. So, Dr. Osment, they were having, like, sneak me through the children's hospital to get up. And there was one nurse up there that, I mean, yelled at me the first time I was there because you're only supposed to have two people in there and all this stuff. So, I go up there one day and they sneak me all through. It takes me, like, 15 minutes to get up to the room. But then they have to, like, release me in there by myself. And so, I'm going to the glass doors where Parker is. And that nurse that yelled at me last week, she's right by the glass doors.
Oh, Lord.
So I'm like, how am I going to navigate this? So I get to the doors, and I said, I'm here to see Parker Bird. She goes, are you his pastor?
Absolutely.
Hey, I couldn't do it.
You couldn't do it?
I couldn't do it. I looked at her. Hey, I said, hey, there's some things that you might be able to fib, but I can't fib. I looked at her, and I said, no, ma'am, I'm the head baseball coach at East Carolina. And she just kind of looked at me, and she goes, okay, you can go with
it. There's some things in Greenville, North Carolina that get you in places even better than being a pastor. Yeah.
And so, you know, I was doing okay selfishly, and But I told you this. So I go on vacation every year right before school starts. The Lafferty's from Ole Miss. I'm the godfather of his kids. And we have this – and I'm like, Jeff, like, Parks been in the hospital 10 days, man. Like, I've had it. But he's like, you got to go. Like, yeah. You have to go. So – but I'm in constant communication with Jeff while I'm on vacation. And on that Wednesday, I'm there for a week. He calls me, and it's about 9 o'clock in the morning. He says, hey, Parker's going to have to get his leg amputated, and it's going to be above the knee, which is probably going to mean he's never going to play baseball again. And, man, put me on my knees, man, because I told you this earlier, too, and P knows this, but the guy that was driving the boat, I had let him on the team kind of last minute, but I had done all my homework.
Yeah.
But I felt at that moment I was responsible for Parker's
leg.
You
felt condemnation.
I've never felt that low before, I don't think. And I just got on my paddleboard, and I just told everybody, I said, hey, look, I got to get away for a little bit. Like, I'll catch up with y'all later. And I just cried. And it put me in a spiral in a bad way, for sure. Then I got COVID again, and it just kept going. And I didn't see hope. I didn't see light at the end of the tunnel. And winning had been such a drug for me that – and the winning wasn't doing it for me anymore. Mm. And so get to November, and I'm like, man, I got to start taking care of myself, or, like, I don't know how much longer I'm going to be coaching.
Yeah.
And I had knee replacement surgery, and it was November 6th. Went great, except, you know, I was going to be the tough guy, not spend the night at the hospital. And when I got home from Cary, it was about 9:30 at night. I've never been in so much pain.
Mm.
I had a toothbrush I was biting down on. I slept for like 15 minutes. Like, hey, man, we got to get some pain meds up in here. Hey, something
quick.
I'm going to be crazy. But I get through it, do all my rehab. I'm 5 weeks out, and all of a sudden my knee starts hurting again and swelling up a little bit. And then I see Kevin Youngs, and he's like, hey, why is the top part of your incision red? Kevin, I don't know. You're the professional. You tell me. And he had me call my surgeon. My knee was infected. I was in surgery the next day. At 8:30, I was in Cary. He stuck a big needle in my knee, drew blood out, sent me to the ER. That afternoon, about 2:30, they cut me back open. Thank God they didn't have to take the equipment out, because if they take the equipment out, it's 3 months without the equipment, and then you got to go back in there and do the knee replacement again. So they threw antibiotics in there, but I was in the hospital for 3 days when I should have been in the Bahamas hanging out with GB and Eric Backage and Chad Tracy and their families, which we only get together like once every four years.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. And so I was depressed. I had them take me out of the group chat for a little bit, because they're putting pictures in there from Bahamas. I'm laid up in the hospital, and had a pick line on my arm for 6 weeks. And I never leaned on people, because I always thought I could handle it myself. Mm-hmm. And Mike Amann, just has been such a huge person of support and faith base with me. And he walked in my life in 2020. And as I said earlier, you don't know when God puts people in your life. You don't know that you need them right then, but And if it's not for it, if you'd have told me 2 years, I was going to say this publicly, but Mike Amann, Irma Lappin, who, hey, she's my therapist.
Yeah, she's amazing.
She saved my life. Mike saved my life, which they've saved my life through God.
Amen.
Because in the fall of 22,
you're in a
Some days I didn't want to live, man.
Yeah.
And
wow.
But I needed it.
Yeah.
But I can tell you this. As I told all my closest friends, it felt like I was in the bottom of the most murkiest pond. And you look up, and, man, all you see is darkness, dude.
Mm-hmm.
And those two people specifically helped me get through it, along with Garrett Blackwood or Chad Tracy, John Williamson, Nick Schnabel, Eric Backage, my closest circle group, Chip Davis, John Gavigan. Hey, man, you need to go to church. Yeah, I'm not doing that. I don't want to talk about baseball, so I'm not going to church.
For sure.
You know, hey, I might watch it online every once in a while, but, hey, man, I ain't going into no church. And so you fast forward, and we get through last year, and, you know, I'm feeling a little bit better, but it still ain't right.
Yeah.
And this fall, I mean, Carter Cunningham, Parker, just being around our guys, like, they kept me going, man. Yeah. And then we get closer to Christmas, and lived in Greenville for over 10 years now. Never had stepped foot in a church.
Wow.
In Greenville, North Carolina. And around December, we do have a staff Bible study that Heath Blackman, our director of player development, runs. So we do every Monday mornings at 8:45. And I just felt like God was like, hey, man, like, you need to go to church, dude. Like, what are you doing?
what are you doing?
You know, and my parents, I love them to death. And they're like, my mom plays the piano at church still. My dad's super Christian. And they never pushed, which they probably knew my hard-headedness if they had pushed it on me. I'd have been like, hey, look.
This is over.
Yeah. And so, anyway, Blake Hardegree, our director of baseball operations, was like, hey, man, you've been going to Open Door, right? And Irma, of course, goes to Open Door.
She's
and
amazing.
I hope she listens to this because I love her. She's just been great for me. But he says, yeah. I said, well, I need an accountability partner, but I want to ride with you and Sarah.
Yeah.
I don't want to walk in it by myself. Awesome. Like, this is crazy. Head baseball, like, hey, don't want to walk in church by himself. And so Christmas Eve was the first church service I came to Open Door. And, man, all I could do was cry. Like, I was like, hey, and I didn't bring a napkin or a Kleenex.
We don't give those out at the door.
Well,
either,
no. So. And, just and so, cups. And of course,
you and your dad needed one too.
Hey, and of course, yeah, Jeff and I cry too much, I think. But
I love it, man.
But I'm looking around like, man, people are like, probably looking at me like, what the hell's wrong with that guy, you know? And so, come Christmas Eve, and then, of course, all the way up until, you know, the Sunday before season starts, because we did that like a opening day. And but I got to tell a story about your mom, because it's just a great story. But the third time I'm coming to Open the Door was the first time I came without Blake and Sarah. So I get here early, sitting by myself, look up my peripheral vision, which I tell these guys all the time, they don't have any peripheral vision because they're stuck in their cell phone all the time.
That's right. They don't know that skill.
And I see this nice, you know, older grandmother-ish looking lady talking to this couple, and I'm literally praying in church, like, please don't let her walk down this aisle. I'm the only one sitting here. I know it's coming, but please don't let her do it. And, of course, she's coming. And I'm like, oh, my God. And I got no idea that it's your mom.
Yeah.
And she goes, hey, you look familiar. Are you friends with my son, Aaron? No, ma'am, I know him, but, you know, one of my best friends, Garrett Blackwater, is close with him. Yeah. Well, why do you look so familiar?
I don't know.
And I'm trying not to say, hey, I'm the head baseball coach. Exactly, yeah. I'm trying to go, to hey.
Like, anywhere.
Hey, I'm from Snow Hill. Like, hey,
that's
awesome. And she just keeps, you know, but it was God. And she goes, why have you only been here three times? And I go, and I just start bawling, crying, because I'm embarrassed about what I'm about to say. And I go, well, because I don't want to talk about baseball. And she's like, oh, my God, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
But she said, hey, I get it. I understand the burden of leadership. Yeah. And I'll never forget that. And my dad is going through, he had some surgeries, but he's going to be fine. He's going to go through radiation. But I told her that. And I sent, like, a prayer request. Yeah. And they were awesome. And I feel bad. I don't even remember who was responding to me. But following up, like, how did the surgery go? Yeah. And everything, and I just appreciated that moment. And
it was so cool, man, from my perspective, because mom, she obviously told me that story. She's like, yeah, she said, I hope I didn't do anything wrong. And I said, no, mom. I said, in fact, you did what we do. Mm-hmm. And the truth is, like, why I want them to feel safe here, and that it's not just about baseball. And so the best thing you could do was go up and talk to him. Not because he's Cliff Godwin, the baseball coach, but because he's Cliff Godwin, the person. And the truth is, like, what people don't realize is that, and we've talked about this, it is one of the most amazing things to do what you do where you grew up, you know? And my world's not the same as your world, but it is the fact I've grown up here my entire life, and it is some of the best people on the planet. But it becomes very small at times, too. Mm-hmm. And so there is that place that you want to be known as Cliff, which is why you have such a close inner circle of friends. And there's places that Lauren and I just want to be known as Lauren and Aaron. And that becomes very hard. Even in your world, it becomes very difficult for the title not to become your identity.
That's right.
And it's really what you've been talking about a lot is that's that journey of how do I separate from what I do to who I am when so many people around me, they all they see is what I do. And the truth is like that's a journey for all of us, but especially when you're in that public eye. And it's a big deal.
Well, and, you know, I used to be able to, you know, and I tried not. Like, I don't ever look at the comments, like, on social media and stuff.
That's the worst
thing. These guys do, like, they'll like, hey, coach, you see, you know, whatever. And I don't even know why I started doing it. My dad asked me one time, but why did you start putting devotionals on? And I didn't have an answer for him. But I just wanted to, I guess, flood social media with
something good.
Something good.
Mm-hmm. And every day, so those that don't know, on Twitter, on Instagram,
don't quote me every day because most days
he's going to post his devotional, and it's really, I mean, that's all it is, and it's a wonderful thing of just like focusing what this is all about. It's really cool, man.
Yeah, and but the stuff wears on you, and when I was going through that dark time, and I think COVID, because we all got isolated a little bit, then it was almost like it was easy for me to like never go out to eat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just go straight home from work
and
just be at home and not. And it was like I was just going into a darker place.
That's right.
And this is the worst thing you can do. But everybody tells you that and you don't want to hear it.
No.
You're like, hey, man, like I hear you, but yeah, I'm not going to the basketball game tonight. I'm not going to the football game. I'm not doing that because it feels like a lot of people have withdrawn from you, but you never feel like the investment back yourself.
Right.
And the thing I would tell anybody in a leadership position, if you don't start taking care of yourself, you'll get to a point like I was at.
That's exactly
right. And you're at a point where you're like, I don't know if I'm going to do this anymore.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what I'm going to do. And then it becomes scary. Like, what are you going to do?
Yeah.
But it's really the devil that's working, going, hey, man, like, you're not as good as you thought you were. You know, and it brings in the shame, the guilt of all the stuff that you've done in the past. And that's the thing that I have as I've gotten older. I can remember in college, and one of my teammates would always do, like, the prayer.
Mm.
And then he would be back with us as we're getting hammered. And I'm like, man, I ain't.
Something's off with this.
I'm like, I ain't doing that because I don't want to be a hypocrite.
Yeah.
Well, we all have fallen short.
That's right.
And we're all sinners. And I think that's the thing that I judge a lot less. Mm.
That's awesome.
And I try to, Blake says this all the time, be curious, not judgmental, because you need to find out where people come from. And people don't know, like, people. And the thing that I was, like, so embarrassed about when I first started having all those depression issues was, like, what does Garrett think of me, man?
Yeah.
All these guys looked at me like I was the tough dude. I could go through anything, and I'm broken right now.
Yeah.
Like, how do they look at me?
That's right.
But it's really the devil going,
amen.
Hey, man, like, these guys don't love you anymore.
That's right.
But they loved me.
Oh, man,
hey,
they
it didn't
you.
Matter.
Yep.
It didn't matter what
and
I was doing.
It's in truth how you find out who your real friends are.
Yeah.
And why I talk about counseling all the time and believe in being in it is because, like, we need to make it normal for people to get help, not this thing. Because the longer you sit in it alone, and we all come to this place.
Yeah.
Like, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Like, you're sitting here, you're younger, you know, and you've gone through a lot of stuff in your life. But we all get to the place that we need help.
Mm-hmm.
And the more normal it is and the more we teach people and have these honest conversations so that people don't feel like they have to be strong, but they reach out for help faster, the better off they'll be in their life and the faster they'll get through it. And God's used all that in your life. But I think about, like, those people that you mentioned. They're unbelievable people. And it's amazing who God surrounded you with in a very dark moment to bring you to where he has you now. You know, it's just unreal. Yeah. And then to be in this moment, seeing what God's doing in this team, it's just, it's only God can write stuff like that.
Well, and the reason that I went to Irma to start with is because my ex-girlfriend used to work out with her.
Oh, wow.
And if you know anything about me, like, I ain't walking into somewhere that there's not a connection.
Somewhere.
There's a connection. And I knew how she had talked about her, about
that's
being
awesome.
A good person that she could just lean on. She won't go into therapy, but she
just somebody they would
share
with.
And so I called her and told her how dark of a place I was in, and she goes, well, you need to call Irma.
Yeah.
And then Irma, of course, has to call her guy, like, now anything that is said in here. Yeah. Like, he's got to give me permission to tell you. I know we're friends, but – and I was so embarrassed first day I walked through the doors, like, you know, looking around, like, who's going to see me walking in? And if you'd have asked me 2 years ago, would I be talking about this? I'd have said, absolutely not. Yeah. I'm embarrassed. But I'm not embarrassed
about
it.
That's so good, man.
And another thing, and my parents would probably kill me for saying this, but I found out that I'd never forgiven my parents. And they're not bad people. No. And I'm still working on it. But I felt like I was lied to, not verbally.
Right.
But I was the kid that saw his buddy's parents get divorced and go, man, that sucks.
Yeah.
That'll never happen to me.
That's right.
And then it happens. Then it happens, and it's like you don't process it. You just go live your life. So stuff is going to – it's going to come back at some point in time and pull you back if you haven't processed it, talked, and give it to God. And that's the thing I love about Irma is it's faith-based therapy.
Amen.
Like, I couldn't see myself doing anything but faith-based
therapy. No, no. Well, I mean, it's just so powerful because so much of the things that the enemy has a foothold in our life come through unforgiveness. And sometimes as kids, we don't even know that we're unforgiving. There's just moments that happen in our life that truly impact our life and the trajectory of our life. And having somebody that can help you go back and say, where are these things that happened that really impacted you, but you didn't even know it at the time? I mean, it's unbelievable. And it really is. I mean, forgiveness is hard, and it's work. Like, it's deep work, man. And it's not something you just do in a moment. It's something that, like, you have to continue. It's what the beauty of communion is. And that's why, you know, we take communion every week. And I tell people, because communion, the act of taking communion is meant to be to assess your relationship with God and to assess your relationship with others. And it's why I believe that Jesus said, whenever you gather, do this. Because he's saying every time you gather in church or with other believers, you should always be assessing where are me and Jesus at, but where are me and others at? Because the most important thing is to keep our hearts clean, you know, and that just that's intentional. Like, there's a lot of people today that they don't feel God, you know, and a lot of times it's because something's off with them and another believer or something in their past. So it's like really deep work, man. It's good. Well,
and as you were talking about this, and I apologize to the guys that played for me early in my career, and Parker, you know, has seen the better side of me because God's in my life a whole lot more. But, I mean, I was kind of a tyrant.
Yeah.
I was kind of a, hey, man, you're going to do it this way, and we're going to win games. And it wasn't like I mistreated them. But now, as I tell our coaches, I go, God gave Adam and Eve free will.
That's right.
And that's what it should be. So I can provide them, hey, I think this is going to work for you. But ultimately, they have to choose
and have to take responsibility.
And have to take responsibility for, hey, man, your swing doesn't look good, but if that's what you want to go with, we'll let you go with it. Yeah. But, hey, I've been doing this for a while. We might want to tinker with this
a little bit.
But that's the thing. I mean, God's just softened me from that standpoint. I still struggle with the losses and the wins. As in our Bible study today, it was like, hey, what's one thing you want to work on this week with your faith? And it's like not getting caught up in the wins so much.
Yeah.
You know.
It's awesome.
And it's the Parker Birds of the world. It's the car and all the guys that have just been in our program, and you see them just grow up and become men. And yeah, you want them to be great baseball players, but I want them to be great men.
That's right.
I want them to get married and have kids unlike me, because I've had my own struggles. And funny story, trying to be closer with the freshmen this year, and so about every Sunday after practice in the fall, I'd get them in a circle and we just would talk, just whatever. Well, one Sunday I said, hey, if every one of you guys can ask me one question.
That's brave.
Yeah. I wish I'd have thought about it a little bit more before I went
there.
We'll
do that again, right?
So we're going around, and, you know, it's just normal stuff. And then Corey Costello, he's a freshman left-handed pitcher. He goes,
I can only imagine what this is.
Yeah, he says, Coach, why have you never been married?
Mm.
And I pause for a second, and, you know, my mind's going, well, you can just brush this off, or you can dive in deep. And so I shared the story of my parents, and the thing I didn't share, but I mean, at an early age, you know, I was exposed to something that I'm not going to get too detailed with it because I don't want to put that person that. But at a young age, when I was in third grade, I saw something that
you shouldn't have seen.
Yeah. And by a person that was older than me, and you know, experiment and stuff, and I never thought it was a big deal. But it impacted me because I was exposed to something at a very young age that your eyes shouldn't see.
That's exactly right.
And that's what Irma has helped me with. But that was another reason that I've really had trouble with female relationships. Like, I think Garrett, everybody will tell you, I'm a great friend, as I've always been, but I've never been loyal to females. And it's something that I'm trying to work through right now, because I actually – and it's probably never said this publicly, but I do want to get married one day. Amen. Which 2 years ago, I'd have been like, nah, I'm good.
I'm not going down that road. It's amazing the healing that's taking place, man. God's doing it. Well, Parker, this may be a dangerous question, but like, what have you seen like in this whole process? Because this is very different for you. I mean, you know, everybody's aware of the journey. And then, you know, just what, a few weeks ago now, you had your first at bat. And I mean, that was emotional. I mean, golly, everybody was crying over that, you know. And I told your dad before it happened, I was like, when this does happen, I said, your phone is going to start ringing. And then sure enough, Trump calls. But like, what's your perspective? Is like, you're 18, right?
Right.
And you're in this, and then like walking through this and seeing a coach who's so vulnerable. Now in a world that isn't vulnerable like that, but what's going off in your brain and your heart, and what are you thinking?
I think that just like allows everybody just to have so much more trust in like the whole entire system of East Carolina, just because like we have a leader like Coach Godwin that is so vulnerable and open about really everything, and he's not just doing this right now on this podcast because you guys are here, but he's same way with the team. And I mean, you want a leader that you can trust on, and somebody that you know is there and has your back. And I mean, that's what we got here, and that's why people commit here, is because the coaching staff and the great fan base that we were talking about earlier. But I mean, just him giving me an opportunity. I mean, that's what I just anywhere I got, I've had a lot of opportunities to go other places in my recruiting process, and I mean, God chose me to come here because he knew what was going to happen, and he knew the impact that I would have on other people and the platform and the coaching staff that would believe in me. And I mean, that's all it's about. I mean, something that he was working before I even knew. And so thankfully both of my parents even went here, or else I wouldn't have been an East Carolina fan. So I mean, he's been working on this for 40 something years, and so just getting the opportunity by these guys and them believing in me even after everything happened. And because it'd been easy just to give up and lose hope, but just them seeing the good.
Well, I think it's also awesome that, you know, you've got some older guys in the program who love Jesus, you know, and like knowing that, I mean, that's just, it's almost like you're in this perfect position that only God could make up, because you're doing things that nobody's ever really done before.
Right.
And yet you have people around you that are keeping you centered, not just on accomplishing something,
right,
you know, physically, but also really the development of you spiritually and holistically, which is a big deal.
Yeah, I mean, Carter said before the season, like, I'll never forget this. He's told us in our Bible studies, like, you know, like, I don't even worry about my bats anymore, because, like, before I go up there, I pray, but God already knows what I'm going to do. And he's like, he knows if I'm going to hit, strike out, but at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. Like, I mean, baseball is this little game in life, but the ultimate goal is to get to heaven, and baseball is just our platform. And so, really, ever since then, I've kind of viewed it as just more my platform than my life. Even though, I mean, obviously, I love baseball with all my heart, and that's really what I live for, but I know that there's a bigger purpose now, and that God is the ultimate goal. And so, just relying on, Charlie's been a great mentor to me, Carter, both those guys, just going to Bible study with like Todd Howe and all those good guys, and just seeing the relationships that I formed throughout this whole process has been awesome. And the Christ Center relationships is really the main thing, because I mean, I've reached out to a lot of people, but the amount of like God moments has been unreal. I can't really put into words of how much he's worked in my life just to get to where I am now.
Yeah.
Well, so cool.
I got to ask you, though, like, because a few weeks ago you did have your first at bat. You know, like, what was that like for y'all, too? Because, I mean, that's
yeah, it was, I mean, he came up to me, I think it was seventh inning. Or actually, he came up to me before the game and was like, hey, like, if you get a, we get a lead, like, be ready. And I was like, all right, like. Then we put up a seven spot in the first, so I was like,
"This is a good night."
How early do I have
to be ready? I was like, I think today's the day, and then
I think today's the day.
You know, the offense kind of stalled out for a couple innings, and then they scored a little bit, and I was like, "Well, maybe not today. Maybe like God's not placing it today." And I was like, "All right." Then offense got rolling again. I was like, "Heck yeah! Like let's go." And he came up to me. I think it was either bottom of seventh or top of seventh, but he's like, "Hey." Start swinging a bat, and when you're in the dugout, you hear that a lot, so you don't get your hopes up too much. But I mean, you go under in our mud room, and there's like this pop up net, and I start hitting off the tee because I mean I hadn't done anything in 2 hours, so just getting loose again. And I came back out, and I was watching Norby shove in the top half of that inning, and then he comes back in, he's like, "Hey, you're hitting second in the lineup in this inning," and. And I don't even think I had any thoughts except, let's go, let's do this.
That's awesome.
And because, I mean, I've been dreaming of it for 2 years almost. And just being able to have the opportunity, I mean, I was so ready for it. And I was so ready for a fastball at first pitch. I was going to swing out my shoes, even though. but, I mean, obviously God let me walk. But me and my dad were talking about it, and somebody actually brought it to me, like, I think the walk was a perfect fitting for that situation because 19 months earlier, like, I wasn't even able to walk.
That's good.
So, golly, that's me, so good. Me walking 90 feet was just to share his glory and his mercy is just incredible. So, like, I think the walk was, like, the perfect fitting that's just awesome. for that moment.
What about you, man? What was your thoughts, Cliff?
Man, I first go back to the fall, and I'm going to throw Jeff under the bus a little bit here. and – we had 41 players on our – or 42 at the start of the fall. Wow. So, the day before opening day, which this year was February 16th, you have to have a 40-man roster.
Yeah.
And if you're not on the 40-man, then you can't play in a game. So, this fall, I mean, I'm worried, like, hey, man, how's this going to play out? And I'll be honest with you, I probably didn't pray about it enough, but it was just like the devil was weighing that.
Man,
I mean,
huge.
I thought about it every single day. And so – one guy we let go or whatever in the middle of the semester. Now we're down to 41. Well, we're having end of year player meetings, and a young man walks in and says, "Hey, coach, I know I can't pitch here. Like, yeah, I'm not ready for this. I had Tommy John. I'm just not back, and so I'm going to leave." And which I appreciated. Yeah. So that made us to 40. Well, I'm holding that nugget to meet with Parker and be like, "Hey, man, you made the 40 man." So Parker comes in for his end of fall meeting, and I forget how it's going. And he's like, "Yeah, my dad's like texting me yesterday, going, 'Hey man, you made the 40 man.'" And I'm like, "Jeff,"
"Why are you doing this,
man? Hey, you're taking away, like, I've been stressing about this for 4 months, man.
Take away my thunder."
Yeah. And that's just, I mean, with locker room talk, man, like, you heard that the guy left, and. In my head, well, Dad had already planted a seed that there's 41 men and
we gotta get somebody off this
40,
bus,
right? So he was worried about it. I wasn't too worried about it because, you know, I mean, if Coach Conway told me I had a red shirt this year, it wasn't the end of the world. Like, whatever is his time, and I'm here for it. And so I was like, I mean, whatever happens, like,
that's awesome.
if I have to be ready next year, I'll be ready next year. If it's this year, I mean, let's do it. But so then, you know, you hear it, and then I text my dad, and I was like, "Hey, such and such, like, is leaving." And he said, "Let's go." I'm like, I was like, "Dad, like, what do you mean, let's go? Like, you don't need a, like, thankful that guy's gone." I was like, he might have been a pivotal piece in this program one day.
That's exactly how I responded.
I was
like, "Dad."
I think I replied, I was like, "What do you mean?" And he goes, "That means you're on the 40-man roster." I didn't process in my head. I was like,
"Your dad,
I guess you're right."
He had counted everybody multiple times, knew what pieces had to move.
He was calling other programs like, "Hey, look, this guy tried to get in." Exactly.
He's a great pitcher.
This kid is amazing.
She recruited him. So he told me, and I was excited.
Yeah.
But, I mean, still hearing the word from Coach G, I mean, it's something you were looking forward to for over a year. So just – hearing those words and getting the opportunity is really everything.
Yeah. Well, one of the coolest moments for me before game day when Parker got his at bat was when he got his first hit, yeah. And it was on a Sunday, and Jeff brought this to my attention because I called him afterwards, and but you know, Parker's hat that's got the Parker Bird logo, yeah. That kind of looks like an East Carolina hat because mm-hmm. It's purple and it's got the white facing, but it's got Parker's logo on the front. I mean, I have that hat in my office, so just on that Sunday,
you're wearing
right. I just grabbed it out of my office and go out to practice, and I hadn't worn it all spring, and so we're inter-squadding, and Parker hits a line drive to right field. Well, and I think I've told Parker this, but as soon as he hits the ball, my eyes go to JC, and I prayed.
Yeah.
I go, hey, man, Lord, don't let him throw the ball to first base.
Yeah, yeah, literally, because
I'm like, God, don't let him. And JC fields it. He never looks at first base, and he's super competitive, and he mm-hmm. just throws the ball to first base.
Wow.
Well, I called JC that night, and I go, hey, man, you made me more proud of you today than anything you've ever done at East Carolina. He's like, Coach, I mean, I just hit one home run in the scrimmage. What are you talking about?
Yeah.
I said, well, when Parker hit that line drive, like, my eyes immediately went to you, and I'm like, Lord, please don't let him throw the ball to first base. He goes, Coach, I didn't even think about throwing it to first base. And I said, well, that's a God moment because I know how competitive you are.
Yeah. Yeah.
You just – he didn't allow you to think about that.
Yeah.
He just threw the ball to second base. And I called Jeff afterwards, and we're, like, super emotional.
Yeah.
And Jeff – I'm sure has told you this, but I think Jeff has struggled with this at times more than Parker
has. Sure.
Parker has. And so he's like, hey, man, you know what hat you had on today? And I was like, now that you bring it to my attention, yes.
Yeah.
But I didn't plan it. Like, I just grabbed it out of my – and we're talking about it's a God thing. And I said, dude, when I was 19 years old, let me tell you what I wasn't doing. Bringing people towards Christianity.
No.
I said, Parker spoke back home in Lomberg, and five people got saved last
week.
Exactly. I go, I know you tell me that I'm where I should be, but I'm telling you where you that God has you where you're supposed to
be.
Right. And then he tells me that week there's a couple that comes in with a newborn baby.
That's it.
That doesn't have tibia and fibula or however you say that. I probably messed that up.
Yeah.
Just has a foot on the bottom of the knee. And Jeff says, I just told them when the time's right, I have resources and connections.
Yeah.
And they look at him and go, no, we're here because of Parker's story.
Oh,
that's why we're coming to see you.
That is,
and I'm getting chill bumps telling them. And I go, Jeff, God's got you right where you're supposed to be.
It's amazing.
That's so cool.
And I tell people all the time, I actually went to talk at a prayer breakfast in Washington this morning, but I was just telling everybody, like, God allowed this to happen to me, but specifically for me. Like, he knew that I was in the right place in the right time, that he prepared this moment. But in high school, I mean, I was working out three times a day, hitting twice. Like, I had this work ethic way before my accident. And people always, now that my life is kind of in the spotlight now, like, Parker has this amazing work ethic, like, after an accident. And, like, it's not anything new to me and my family. We're just like, he's Parker. And I'm just, like, storing what I did before. And but it's just, like, the impact that I've had. And, I mean, it's nothing I've ever asked for, and I don't deserve it. But it's just something that he gives me, and I just really give all the glory to him because, I mean, I don't deserve it at all. And he's just giving me that spotlight.
It's being cool. I mean, we live right close to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And my wife and I, we were walking our dog one night.
Yeah.
This is my favorite Parker Bird story. And so Jeff comes into the neighborhood late because he's a doctor in town, awesome doctor, and my son's a doctor. Anyway, so we're driving in. We're walking, and he's driving in. It's probably like 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, you know. And so we're trying to get this dog walked. And I kid you not, Jeff pulls into the driveway and then immediately, like, pulls back out. And drives back by us, like, leaving the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
And I text him. I'm like, what in the world are you doing? And he was like, Parker want to go hit. And it was like 10 o'clock at night, and he had just come home and picked up Parker after working all day and then was taking you to go hit. And I was like, man. And it's a true testimony because, like, I have a 15-year-old. I have a 9-year-old, you know. And both my boys, they're into baseball. But it's so amazing to hear how they view you. Yeah. Even though I don't know if you've ever actually met him.
No, I don't think I have. Or maybe once.
But like just seeing how they look up to you mm-hmm. and your work ethic. And yet not only that, but having somebody who has a work ethic like that.
Yeah.
And then also loves Jesus.
Yeah.
Like, man, how God's using this is just, I mean, y'all are sowing seeds today
mm-hmm.
that maybe we will never know the impact that they have on generations to come.
Yeah.
And it is a pretty unique moment to watch how God has brought all this together. And, I mean, there should never be a doubt for you that you're in the right place at the right time. And just grateful, man.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just crazy just to see the kids now at the games. It's just, like, unreal to me just because, like, and me and Carter talk about this all the time, and obviously Carter's having a lot of success right now, and I pick on him all the time and call him, I'm like, you're him, bro. He hates it because, like, he's trying to give all the glory back to God.
Yeah.
And that's just, like, really the staple of our team this year is, like, we're not doing this for us. Like, this is just, we pray before every game that our glory is all to him and that Amen. We use our platform of baseball to shine his light and that whatever his plan is, that it be implied in the game. And uh-huh. so, I mean, that's our team this year. I mean, there's no other words. And discipline equals freedom is our motto this year. And that's what we really live by. And we're all disciplined enough to trust in the Lord and that we know that he will give us the freedom to do whatever in life if we just lean on him.
It's awesome, man.
One quick thing, because, you know, our guys get baptized on the field. And,
yeah.
And that was a big deal.
15 of them, right?
I think 11.
11 or 15. Yeah.
That's a pastor's counting right there.
Yeah, yeah. We always add two.
Yeah, add two or three, yeah.
Exactly.
But I was actually in church at Open Door, and Blake sitting next to me, and I just been struggling with this. I had talked to Irma about it, but I was like, you know, I want to get baptized. But I didn't want to do it at Open Door because I'm like, it's going to be like a spectacle. Yeah. Coach Godwin's getting baptized. Yeah, like, I want it to be more of a personal thing. So Blake with Sportworks, the guys came up with them getting baptized on the field. Like, Coach Godwin had nothing to do with it, was behind the scenes. And Blake just said, hey, are you okay with 10 or 11 guys getting baptized on the field? I'm like, absolutely.
Yeah,
he's like, we're going to get like a big horse trough from some church in Washington.
Awesome.
And Blake's
awesome.
Yeah.
And I'm water like, was so cold.
It wasn't that cold to me because I got a cold punch in my ass. I got in. I was like, this is like 50 degrees, dude. I'm good.
He's old school tough right there. Yeah.
But we're in church, and I just hit Blake on his knee, and I said, hey, I think I want to get baptized with players. And he, like, dropped his phone, like, just, like, so excited.
That's awesome.
And, but none of our players knew. I just say this because I think people think I encouraged, pressured, whatever the word you want to use for our players. But Carter Cunningham's the only one that knew because Blake told him that. So I walked out. They were already out there. And, you know, I didn't even think about this. But he's like, who's going to baptize you? I was like, I don't know. I didn't think about it. I said, but if somebody's going to baptize, it's going to be Mike Amen.
That's right.
And so I called Mike. He goes, absolutely, brother. I'm That's there. Awesome. And but this is probably too personal, but, like, I didn't tell my parents, and I kind of feel bad about it. So, but I did text them right before I was going to get baptized. And me and my dad have a unique relationship because he's my coach, man. Yeah. Like, freaking, I never did anything good enough, man. You know, like, which I wouldn't be where I am today.
Without that.
You know, like, he coached me in basketball. If I messed up the slightest bit, I'm coming out of the game because he never wanted anybody else to think, hey, his son was getting privileged.
That's
which,
right.
If there was everybody thought I was getting privileged, hey, I won't get privileged. Hey, you're lost. I mean, they even caused friction with my mom because she thought I should be playing more, you know. But he texts me something back, and I wish I don't ever bring my cell phone. I don't want to be distracted, but the gist of it was, I've been praying since the day you've been born.
That's powerful.
Right? And he said, I know that I had noticed something that changed in your life like about a year ago, but I didn't know. I couldn't put my finger on it. Mm-hmm. And now it makes sense.
That's so cool. That's awesome. I love this story. I mean, you kind of step back and look at the interweaving that God does throughout both you guys' story, and it's just like, man, a lot of pain, right?
Yeah.
And a lot of obviously difficulties, but God had a plan throughout the whole thing, saw the whole thing. And how cool is it to look at it and see where baseball was kind of an escape, probably in a lot of ways, that now God's brought it back to be kind of that moment where you get baptized, and now it's your, like you're saying, a platform to kind of lead young men and do that. It's such a cool thing, man.
It's very fitting that we got baptized on the baseball field.
Right. Because, that's crazy. Right.
I mean, that is our platform, but, like, that's also our distraction as well.
Yeah,
like,
that's right.
That's what I invested my life in before the accident, really. And that's really what I live for. Because, I mean, I really spent every single second of my day thinking about how I could get better in baseball. Not life, just baseball. And that, with that being working out 3 to 4 times a day, hitting, it didn't matter as long as I was playing baseball. And this, that distraction, and just knowing that I can play baseball and use that for the good. So now it's just like,
that's awesome, just, man.
Using that for the good. Like, that's this right. is it's so cool just that we got baptized at Clark LeClaire.
So cool.
The place that's changed a lot of people's lives.
Well, and Carter Cunningham, I've coached him for 3 years, but I say this publicly, I don't think people get it. I've never seen a player, and I've coached some really talented players that have played in the big leagues, play as free as that dude's playing right now. Like, if you don't believe in God, if you don't believe in God, go call Carter Cunningham, because last year, and we laugh about this, but we're at Old Dominion, and he's not even a starter. It's a 13. It ends up being a 13 in a game, and Carter would never, ever, like, solely commit to hitting, like, a high spin rate fastball, which is, like, a fastball that is just riding. So they got a righty throwing, and I put him in the game, and I'm at third base box going, well, Carter's got no shot against this guy. Like, I'm telling myself this. Like, hey, I've seen this 1,000 times. And Carter rockets a ball in the right field. And I was like, well. And then he faces the guy again. He rockets a nut. I'm like, and then he took off. But this year, baseball is just a part of what he does. It's not who he is.
That's right.
And like he said, it's like he knows God already knows what the result of this at bat's going
to
be.
It's almost like he's died to it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And having so much fun, but he's so consumed with everybody else on our team or raising money for the Children's Hospital or FCA or doing the team Bible study. Baseball is just like something like a hobby almost.
Yeah.
But he's super talented, but God's allowed him now to play free, where now he's doing stuff on the field. I mean, he had 5 RBIs on Friday night, and it's like the other team's like intentionally walking, like, hey, dude, we ain't pitching this guy.
Yeah. not as hot as he is right now, because he's
not,
a fleet.
Not only are they intentionally walking, but you also have JC behind him, who is one of the best hitters in the country.
That's exactly right.
So, like, just a
when you don't want to go up against those two guys.
I kind of shook my head, like,
that was a bad decision.
Like, you're going to put another RBI basically for JC because he's about to put his ball over the scoreboard.
For sure.
Luckily, the wind was blowing in, so for the other team, I guess. But
that's awesome, man.
That's so cool.
Well, guys, thank y'all for, like, trusting us enough to share the story, man, because it's, like, it's a huge honor, and I mean that, man. Your vulnerability as a coach and willing to share that, thank you.
Well, and I used to care, you know, like, I'd keep everything in, and man, just a lot of weight in my soul, you know, and I'm a normal person who just happens to be the head baseball coach at East Carolina and struggle with the same things that you do and every other male in the, you know, in the country. You know, I just hope it helps somebody.
Yeah.
Well, I know
that's what I hope.
It is. It's helping a lot. It's helping those guys. It's helping. And I think it's going to continue to help.
Oh, man.
It's awesome.
Echoes, man.
Yeah.
It's the echo of God's glory.
Yeah.
It's cool. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, guys.
Appreciate
you. I appreciate you guys. Yeah. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, awesome, man.
Thanks for Jeff putting some pressure on you.
Thank That's Jeff. Awesome, man. Jeff is all about it, baby. Omaha, baby. Here we come. Omaha.
Omaha. Let's go.
Exactly. I'm telling you.